This is Robert H. Jackson's 125th birthday celebratory year. And there is a book that was recently republished by Helen Ebersol, which talks about the life and times of Justice Jackson and his impact in our community while in Jamestown. And foremost among his various activities as a private practitioner was a unique case dealing with the Forbes farm, Forbes Dairy. And we're so thrilled to have two individuals who have researched this and will be discussing this as really underscoring Robert Jackson as perhaps being the first environmental attorney in Chautauqua County. And as part of that story, Helen Ebersol had written a part of her book that's put out, talks about that as well. So I'd like to call up Mary D. Martocci, who will kind of set the stage. Mary D.
Well, good morning, everyone. Don't worry, I'm not going to cover all of this morning. I just have a few things here that I think will be helpful to me. Well, thank you so much, Greg, for having us all together this morning. What an outstanding show of support as I listen to the list of contributors, members of the community, being good corporate citizens. I thought, what a wonderful showing of the work that you are doing and the work that is being done here at the Jackson Center. And I'm so pleased, I was pleased yesterday and I'm pleased today to know that there are some members of the Forbes family who are here. It's great, and I look forward after the presentation this morning to having a chance to chat with you. Leave it to Greg to compel me to look at something that I think I know about and to think about it in a new way. When I did the work on the Forbes Dairy case about a year and a half ago, my emphasis, what I was interested in, was Robert H. Jackson's career, the building blocks that got him to the culmination of his career, really dual culminations, I guess, and that is as an associate justice on the United States Supreme Court and, of course, as the lead prosecutor for the Nuremberg trials. And so my emphasis as I reviewed the Forbes Dairy case originally was thinking about how that case was a significant building block in his career and in preparing him for the pinnacle assignments of his career. And when Greg contacted me a couple of months ago and explained to me the program that he was thinking about for this morning, it compelled me to go back and take a look at the Forbes Dairy case from the standpoint of Robert H. Jackson as an environmental lawyer and one of the leaders, really, in establishing the importance that we now, and I hope continue to place, on the sanctity of our environment and preserving it. So, with that, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the Forbes Dairy case. I believe that the paper which I wrote, which has been published on the website, is in the materials that you have today, so if you're really interested and want to know more about it, you can look at that. And I know that there are lots of other community resources as well. So now I'm going to see how techy I am and if I can actually move the slides on this. Oh, look at that. Great. Okay. Those of you who listened to the introduction may have noticed the piece that I received my Bachelor of Arts degree from the University of North Dakota. I grew up in farm country. So I know a little bit about looking at farms, and one of the lessons that I remember as a young girl is, if you want to make a judgment about whether a particular farm is a success, look at the size and the condition of the barn. And that will tell you a lot about whether that particular rural enterprise is a successful operation. Well, based on, this is the Forbes family farm at the time of the trial or thereabouts, so 1923, 24, 25, somewhere in there. I'm not exactly sure when this photograph was taken. But based on what I see there, a substantial house, a substantial barn, two large silos, everything apparently neat and well cared for, my judgment is that this was a successful dairy operation in 1923 up until the time that the typhoid contamination struck. And indeed, the testimony at the trial bore that out. This farm was was owned by Grant and Velma Forbes. They farmed, they owned 100 acres. Their son Merle owned an adjoining 64 acres, which he lived on with his wife Ida. And another son, Ray, worked as part of the dairy operation. Mr. Forbes, Grant Forbes, had been farming this property since 1899. He testified at the trial that in 1923, before the typhoid epidemic, he was supplying about 600 quarts a day to commercial establishments and along a particular residential delivery route in Jamestown. I see some of you who look to me like you're old enough to remember the days when milk was delivered at home. I certainly do. In fact, I remember as one of four kids that we had two different dairies who delivered milk. That way, at least one bill would always be paid, and the milk would continue to be delivered. In any event, the Forbes family delivered milk along a particular residential route in Jamestown in the early part of the 20th century. The farm was located, now I need to go to my next slide here. I'm going to back up a little bit. This is obviously, as you can tell, this is Lake Chautauqua. The farm is located to the east of the southern end of Lake Chautauqua. The main water supply for the farm was the Casadega Creek. And I'm going to back up. This slide, and what I'm showing you now are copies of exhibits that were used at the trial. This slide shows the oxbow, that sort of loopy thing right in the middle. That is the route of the Casadega Creek, and those oxbows created areas where all sorts of things could accumulate. And the oxbows were significant factors and a significant point of discussion during the trial. The testimony was that those oxbows, particularly when the water was low, were ideal locations for the collection of debris, dead fish, feces, toilet paper, all sorts of unpleasant things collected in those two oxbows. And did they contaminate the creek? Well, that was, of course, one of the hot questions at the trial. The city of Jamestown began dumping all of its untreated sewage into the Casadega Creek in 1895, all of it. That's sort of incomprehensible for us today to think about that, but in fact, that was the practice. Many municipalities disposed of their untreated raw sewage into a convenient waterway. By 1923, there were 40,000 residents in the city of Buffalo. In the city of Jamestown. And all of that refuse from all of those households was going into the Casadega Creek untreated. The spot where it entered the creek was just upstream from the Grant Forms dairy. 1923 was a very dry year in Chautauqua County, very little precipitation. The creek was running very low. It was very slow and very sluggish. And this created an ideal opportunity for the debris, which I've described, to collect in the oxbows that you saw in the earlier slide. In the middle of July, it became obvious that something was going on with some of the residents in the city of Buffalo. They were getting sick. They were developing abdominal problems, high fevers, some of them becoming very sick indeed. And in fact, during the course of the epidemic, there were more than 35 or 40 people who were affected by this. Two of them died. So it was a very serious issue. The public health officer at that time was a man named Dr. John Mahoney. He quickly began an investigation to try to determine, first of all, what the illness was, which, in his opinion, very early on, he determined was typhoid fever. And so then the next step was to determine the source of the contamination of the bacteria that was infecting people. He quickly eliminated the water source as a supply, and therefore zeroed in on another prime carrier of typhoid bacteria, which is milk. He was able to identify, based on the addresses of the people who were getting sick, that there was one dairy which was supplying the milk for most of those people, and that was the Forbes family dairy. Dr. Mahoney called at the farm the middle of July, July 17th is the date that sticks in my mind, explained to the Forbes family, to Grant Forbes and to the other members of the family, his concerns. They all agreed to be tested. The presence of the typhoid bacteria is tested by examining feces, urine, and blood. They all supplied feces, which were sent off to the New York State Department of Health to be tested. In addition to that, Dr. Mahoney ordered that the family stop selling their milk, that the family stop having contact with the preparation of the milk, and ultimately that the milk had to be pasteurized. Today, of course, pasteurization is a no-brainer for us. If you want unpasteurized milk, you can find it in farms here and there, but when you go to the grocery store to buy milk, it's pasteurized, and that's really the standard. But it was not until 1924 that the pasteurization became a requirement for commercial sale of milk. People objected to it because, obviously, for the farmer, the dairy people, it was an expense. And people objected because there was a sense that pasteurized milk had a cooked flavor, whatever that means. I've never tasted unpasteurized milk, so I don't know the difference. But at any rate, the family agreed to do all of it. It agreed to stop having contact with the dairy operation itself. It brought in paid people to do that, and it also agreed to pasteurize the milk, which, of course, was an expense. In due time, some of the test results began coming back for the feces, the family's samples, which had been tested. And it was determined that one of the family members, Ida Forbes, who was married to Merle Forbes, was what is called a carrier. Ida Forbes had worked as a nurse from 1917 to 1920 in a hospital in Pennsylvania where she treated typhoid patients. She had evidently taken in the typhoid bacteria during that treatment, but she never got sick and she had no symptoms. She was known as a carrier. Her presence in the household as a typhoid carrier was a very hot issue at the trial. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a minute. I've picked this slide to show you the Forbes family was very proud of their dairy operation, and I think they should have been. This is the milk house where the milk was collected and processed for distribution. And this is the interior of the milk house. Again, these are exhibits that were used at the trial. Dr. Mahoney, the public health officer, testified at the trial that there was absolutely nothing wrong with the family's method and with the means that they used to collect the milk and to prepare it for distribution. It was all sanitary and done exactly the way it should have been. So there was no careless contamination of the milk that was going on the Forbes farm. Typhoid fever, of course, is a much dreaded disease, and rightly so. People die. It spreads through a population very quickly. It wasn't until the late 1800s that the bacteria which causes typhoid was actually identified. And when the outbreak occurred in Jamestown, the method of transmission was still in dispute. And that was a very hotly contested issue at the trial. Grant Forbes, of course, his dairy operation sustained substantial damage, financial damage, as a result of this whole thing. There was a huge amount of notoriety. There were articles in the Jamestown paper. The public health officer issued a statement, not to drink the Forbes milk. And obviously, this caused significant damage to the dairy. In addition to that, at the trial, Grant Forbes testified that he had complained over the years to various public entities about the condition of the creek, but nobody had paid any attention to him. In any event, Mr. Forbes, Grant Forbes, went to the office of Robert H. Jackson in 1923 to complain about what had happened to him as a result of the typhoid outbreak and what he thought was wrong treatment by the city of Jamestown in terms of his dairy. And Robert H. Jackson took the case and represented Mr. Forbes and his family in its case against the city of Jamestown. There were actually two, the case was tried twice. The first time in 1924, which I think is, this is so interesting from a trial lawyer standpoint, because the event happened in July of 1923. The lawsuit was commenced in December of 1923, and by May of 1924, the case was tried. Now that's Judge Gerasi. That doesn't happen. We have a much longer path from incident to trial these days. In any event, it was tried in 1924. A plaintiff's verdict in the amount of $13,000 was given to the Forbes family. The defendant moved to set aside the verdict. Motion was denied, went to the appellate division. The Fourth Department found that there were errors in the judge's charge and sent it back for a second trial. The second trial was tried in May of 1925, and again there was a plaintiff's verdict returned in the amount of $13,500. Again, the defendant moved to set aside the verdict. It went to the appellate division. The appellate division affirmed the verdict. The defendant, City of Jamestown, moved for leave to appeal to the Court of Appeals, and that was denied. So there was a lot of litigation involved in this case. The city of Jamestown fiercely defended its actions, and I'm sure it was an expense both for the plaintiff as well as for the defendant. Let me talk a little bit about the issues at the trial, and then I will stop talking. This is the manhole for the spot where the sewage from the city of Jamestown went into Casadega Creek. And you can see the sort of bubbly stuff going on in the background, and that is the sewage actually going into Casadega Creek. Now this photo was taken not in the summer of 1923, because in the summer of 1923, the duct that actually dumped the sewage into the Casadega Creek was uncovered. Here it's under the water, so you can't really see what's going into the creek. This is a photo. It's a little hard to see, but down on the lower left corner you can see along the banks where there is all sorts of, looks to me like toilet paper, frankly, up on the side of the creek. This also was used at the trial. This is, according to the testimony at the trial, toilet paper hanging on this piece of tree that's sticking up out of the creek. Now this is my favorite. This is human feces. So you can see, and again, this was, one of the witnesses at the trial testified that he had looked at the creek at the time, closer in time to when this all happened in 1923, and he described a field of human feces 16 feet long, anywhere from 2 to 10 feet wide, and 3 feet deep in the creek. I mean, it's, to me anyway, it's mind-blowing. And this is the list of people who were made ill by the typhoid fever, with the names of two people who died. The youngest was a little boy who was 2, and there were people up into their 70s who were made ill by this. So what were the issues at the trial? Well, of course, the issue of the trial was the source of the typhoid contamination of the Forbes milk. The Forbes family did not dispute that their milk had been contaminated by typhoid. What was tried at the trial was the source of the contamination. The Forbes family contended that the creek was contaminated by the actions of Jamestown, which resulted in raw sewage, toilet paper, slime, dead fish, flies, noxious odors, all as a result of this untreated sewage going into the creek. During the trial, and again, I wonder if this would be allowed today. Judge Taurasi, you probably would have an opinion about this. Grant Forbes brought into the trial in 1925 a jar of water collected from the creek a couple of days before the trial. And he brought in a box of refuse that he had picked up along the shore to demonstrate to the jury the level of contamination in 1925. Now, whether that would be allowed in a trial today for damages happening in 1923, I have my questions about that. So in any event, we know, and people knew in 1923, that typhoid bacteria lives in human feces. The plaintiffs contended that the cows waded into the creek, drank the water, the contaminated feces clung to their hides and clung to their udders, and when they were milked, it was transferred into the milk supply. Interestingly, typhoid bacteria will live on the hide of a cow, on the outside of a cow. It won't live in a cow's stomach. The cow's stomach kills the typhoid bacteria. So if the cow drinks water, which is contaminated, the cow's digestive system kills the bacteria. Therefore, it had to get from the creek to the cow, to the milk, in some way by attaching itself to the outside of the cow. The other theory that the plaintiffs put forward at the trial is that flies were lighting on the contaminated feces and then flying in and contaminating some of the milking equipment in the barn. The defendants, however, contended, the city of Jamestown contended, that the source of the contamination was Ida Forbes, who was a typhoid carrier. Now, there was testimony at the trial that at the time in 1923, Ida was very pregnant, was having a very difficult pregnancy, and was not involved in any of the dairy activities during the relevant time period. But this was a hotly contested issue of fact at the trial. As I said earlier, it was clear and it was agreed at the trial that the condition of the milk house was not a factor in terms of the typhoid transmission. So a few practice issues that I just want to comment on, and then I will turn this back over to Greg. It's interesting to me, the plaintiffs were represented by Robert H. Jackson, as I said. The defendant, City of Jamestown, was represented at trial by a man named Claire Pickard. Claire Pickard was admitted to practice, I think, in 1894. And in 1923, he was an attorney of some repute in the city of Jamestown. You read in the history of the county of Chautauqua, he and his wife were prominent members of the community and people of some standing. Well, Jackson and Pickard had a prior go-round as attorneys before this case was tried in 1923. There was a case entitled Moeller versus Pickard, which was finally resolved by the Court of Appeals, the highest court of the state of New York, in 1921. And in that case, Jackson represented the plaintiffs and sued Pickard. The lawsuit arose out of a business deal involving the Monarch Stationery Company and Pickard's attempt to save the company from bankruptcy. Pickard ended up actually investing in the company in an attempt to save it from bankruptcy. There was a question about whether all parties to the transaction were properly advised of Pickard's role. This apparently happened at the 11th hour to try to save the deal. And Jackson accused Pickard, and I quote, "Pickard was acting in bad faith towards his clients, leaving them to suppose he had no personal interest in the matter of representation when in fact he did. This case, a long procedural history, went to the appellate division, went to the Court of Appeals." Now, Judge Jackson lost the case. The Court of Appeals said no, that this was not sufficient to show that Mr. Pickard had done anything improper. Pickard prevailed. Nevertheless, that kind of an accusation between two attorneys, where one attorney accuses another of acting in bad faith and you take it all the way to the Court of Appeals, had to have created some animosity between the two of them that must have been a factor in the Forbes trial. One of the witnesses was a man named Dr. William Smith, who was the public health officer for Falconer and one other little town. I can't remember what it was. In any event, Dr. Falconer and Ellicott. He submitted feces samples to the New York State Department of Health. Now, there were the samples were done in July of 1923, and then there were repeated testing of later samples by the New York State Department of Health, and also some were sent to Buffalo. And when Dr. Smith submitted the samples the second or third time to the New York State Department of Health, he used fictitious names for the plaintiffs, and Pickard at trial made a great big mess out of Dr. Smith being dishonest and trying to fool the Department of Health, and this was not an honorable thing to do. Dr. Smith's explanation was that he knew that Ida had already been tested as positive, and he didn't want to prejudice the Department of Health by having them get another sample and say, well, this is Ida, we know it's positive. And there was a lot of cross-examination of Dr. Smith by Mr. Pickard during the trial. Judge Jackson was very effective in his redirect in terms of giving Dr. Smith an opportunity to explain what he had done, in fact, that there was a good reason that he had done it. A couple of other things I just want to mention here. The exhibits, as I've sort of hinted a little bit here, there were exhibits allowed during the trial that did not reflect the condition of the creek in 1923 when the typhoid epidemic broke out. Now, I think one of the reasons was that Jackson had not only sued for damages because of what had happened in 1923, but he had also sued for the fact that the creek was an ongoing nuisance. At the trial, the testimony in damages was all about the damages to the dairy and the value of the farm. There was no relief asked for to correct the nuisance of the creek. So I'm not exactly sure how that fits together. There were a lot of leading questions. The transcript is filled with leading questions, which I know would not be allowed today, but they were asked and they were not objected to, so they were allowed. Over the course of the trial, which was 5 days, the plaintiff called 17 witnesses, the defendant called 22 witnesses. There were 60 exhibits. So that's a lot of proof that came in over a 5-day period. And in my mind, some indication of the intensity with which both sides viewed this litigation. The verdict was a compromise verdict, in my opinion, and the first trial resulted in a verdict of $12,000. The second resulted in a verdict of $13,500. The amount sued for was $50,000, which in today's dollars is about $700,000. So as my husband and I were driving here this morning, he's Googling trying to figure out how much $13,500 would be today, $188,000. So, you know, still not an insignificant amount of money, but not the testimony at trial from Mr. Forbes, Grant Forbes, was that his dairy business, that the income from his dairy business has been cut in half from $6,000 a year to about $2,500 or $3,000 a year. The value of the farm had gone from somewhere around, depending on who you believe, $45,000, $50,000, even $60,000 a year to $30,000 a year. I'm sorry, the value of the farm had about been cut in half. Well, if you believe those, then you have to wonder why the verdict was apparently modest. Clearly, the jury believed that the plaintiffs had proved their case in terms of how the bacteria was transmitted to the milk supply, but there was something about the claim for damages, in my opinion, that the jury didn't like. Both sides brought in a number of expert witnesses. Some of them had been subpoenaed. Some of them, I believe, were paid to come in. The defendant brought in three experts from around the country. one person from Harvard, one from the University of Chicago. Now, and a third one, it was not cheap to bring those witnesses in, and probably was 2 days of travel time each way, plus the time that they were here, plus the time that they prepared for their testimony. So there was a lot of money that was spent by the city of Jamestown to defend itself. The plaintiff's witnesses were more local, but again, even a witness who was coming from Buffalo, and there were several expert witnesses from Buffalo, would be a day to get to Chautauqua, to get from Buffalo to Mayville in 1923, and a day to get back, plus the time of the testimony. So a lot. One more point that I just want to make. The defendant's experts had stellar qualifications. One of the witnesses was a Dr. Rosenau, who was regarded as the world expert in environmental hygiene. And he testified for the defendant. So Judge Jackson, in his cross-examination of these highly regarded witnesses with stellar qualifications, had to really think long and hard about how he was going to cross-examine them. He didn't want to give them an opportunity to buff their credentials again. He didn't want to give them an opportunity to give another explanation to the jury of why they were right and the plaintiffs were wrong. But he couldn't ignore their testimony because it was so damaging. So he asked the same question of each of the three defense experts, which I thought was brilliant. What he said was, Dr. Rosenau, your testimony is that the cause of the contamination was that Ida Forbes was a carrier. Is that correct? Is your opinion in this trial based on assuming the correctness of all of the elements of the question on causation? Now, it was asked a little more in everyday words because he had to make his point to the jury. Is your question based on accepting all of the elements of causation as presented by the defendant? And each of the witnesses said yes. When the charge came, he asked for a charge that the jury be charged that if the jury found any element of the hypothetical as put forward by the defendant to be wrong, that it had to return a verdict for the plaintiff. And the judge gave him that charge. So I think that was a huge step in terms of Judge Jackson prevailing. So that's a real quick description of the Forbes trial. As I said earlier, when I looked at this first time around, I looked at it from the standpoint of it as a building block in the career of Judge Jackson. And this case was based on circumstantial evidence. Nobody could see the bacteria on the feces transferred to the cow's udder going into the milk. Couldn't see it. So it was there was circumstantial evidence. Jackson put forth a case based on circumstantial evidence, which, what was his case in Nuremberg? Based on substantial evidence. In my opinion, this case was a huge building block in his career and in his prosecution of the Nuremberg trials. As I said earlier also, I've now looked at this case again in terms of Judge Jackson as a hero for environmental cleanliness. And it's clear to me, this case is cited for the proposition that we don't have the right to befoul public streams. And this case is cited for that proposition. So it's an important case for two reasons in my mind, and probably others that I'm not thinking about right now. Thank you.
Case because of the Forbes
amazing piece of work of which you just spoke. Judge Taurasi, you've dug into the city records most recently. You went over there to City Hall, knocked on the door of the clerk and said, show me a bunch of your records, which goes all the way back to with the city council responding to the lawsuit. They took it pretty seriously, hired a foremost lawyer, Claire Pickard. In fact, maybe, by the way, Judge Taurasi is 90 years old. We had just had a celebration, so congratulations. But you, last night, were telling us that you actually knew Claire Pickard. Why don't you give a little description of him as you remember him?
Clarence Pickard is the one that I tried cases with and against, rather. I was a partner of Mike Lombardo. And they were an interesting couple of lawyers. The attorney Pickard weighed about 300 pounds and was 6'4". Mike Lombardo was about as tall as I am. So they did make an interesting duo, but they were a powerful law firm and very effective trial lawyers. I need to connect Claire with Clarence. That's the connection that I think you were seeking. And I'm trying to get through the obituary records to see just what the connection was there.
I think it was a nephew of Claire Pickard. So it was a family. There was obviously a family connection.
Yes, there is.
Between that process. What I found fascinating in your research, Judge, is though there was circumstantial evidence, which was the process of the case and the underlying aspect of the case, which led to the plaintiff's verdict, but there was no, in the circumstantial evidence, tied in the wastewater treatment system of the city of Jamestown. I found interesting that one of the responses, though, was seemingly denied by the mayor, but shortly thereafter, the city of Jamestown had a significant capital expenditure. You want to talk about that?
Well, it's interesting. Helen Ebersol, who spoke here recently, who was interviewed by the erstwhile Greg Peterson, she wrote an article about the Forbes case, and the title of that was What Caused the Jamestown Typhoid Outbreak of 1923? And in that, she concludes by saying that after the two trials, the mayor decided he would prefer that the city spend money on a sewer treatment plant rather than another lawsuit, because there was going to be further litigation if they didn't build the treatment plant. And so he always denied that the city had anything to do with the typhoid problem and denied that there was that kind of a problem in the river that was described so well by Mary D. But the interesting thing is that, as I sent in a memo to you, in 1917, about four or five years before this all hit the fan, as it were, the city of Jamestown did
No pun intended.
The city of Jamestown had some engineers do some studies of the city's capital projects and works, including streets, including sewer. And what they found was that in weather that we've had similarly, recently rather, where there were heavy, heavy rains, that the city's sewerage system got overflowed and that there was quite a bit of fluid, contaminated fluid, into the river. And the city came up with three or four or five different ideas to try to correct the problem, never did, until the Forbes incident. And the way I got interested in the Forbes case was I had, because of your work here, I had an interest in all the cases that Justice Jackson had in Chautauqua County. And so I had Henry Weiler, who eventually was the county clerk, but I had him dig out all of the recorded cases that he had here in Chautauqua County, and he prepared for me a list of the wins and the losses that the justice had. And among the wins were the two Forbes cases. And that's what got me interested in researching the Forbes case.
Of course, you personally were responsible for sewering, if that's a term, most of Chautauqua Lake. I mean, you participated in that process, which in many senses your subject, which was your research, was involved in the sewering of part of the city of Jamestown.
Yes.
There may or not be a causal connection there, but it's just such an important aspect for public health, for the environment, to have that system in place. And what was in 1923, I can just imagine Robert Jackson listening to Grant Forbes, who's got to be so distressed at that moment. I mean, think about it. There's been an order by the city of Jamestown to effectively displace him and his business and literally attack his, this would have been his sister-in-law, Ida, you know, as a daughter-in-law, as a carrier. I mean, wow. And so as at total wits, their family's at total wits, and I can't imagine what the Forbes family went through. And then Jackson, again, only 10 years in the practice, he's going to take on the city of Jamestown.
There was criticism of the health commissioner, if you will, back then, and even later on, the historians looked at the fact that with all that Mary D. has described, that the city of Jamestown and the health commissioner never really was critical of the system that Jamestown had of dumping all this sewage untreated into the river.
Well, one of the issues at trial when Dr. Mahoney testified for the city of Jamestown, he was the first witness that was called for the defendants, and you could just tell by reading the transcript that he was really anxious to testify and to tell his story and to defend his actions. But he was cross-examined by Jackson very effectively, because Dr. Mahoney had been quoted in articles in 1923, and I think maybe even a little bit before then, talking about how foul the Casadega Creek was and how bad the conditions were. And then he came in and he testified at the trial that it was fine. There was no problem with it. And Mr. Jackson was able to very effectively cross-examine mm-hmm. him with his prior statements. So,
right.
Yeah.
You know that photograph that you had of the manhole cover, that
yes.
real heavy, reminded me of the situation when I was county executive and we were attempting to put in place a corrected sewer treatment system in southern Chautauqua Lake. In Lakewood, where I live, the sewerage lines and the water drainage lines were in the same excavation, and what had happened was that the water drainage lines had deteriorated, and so had the sewer lines, so that any rainwater would filter into the sewerage line. And so whenever there was heavy, heavy rain, you could go down to the beach at Lakewood, where there was a manhole cover right by the in the beach, and that manhole cover would be, by the force of the water, would be lifted up, and the debris would go into the beach, and our beaches would have to be shut down for a time. So that was one of the reasons that we decided we better have an improved sewer treatment plant in southern Chautauqua County.
As a resident of Lakewood, New York, I thank you. this has been remarkable. And I frankly, I want to again thank the Forbes family for making this whole paperwork possible. I want to thank Mary D. and Judge Gerasi, who have separately and now collectively discussed this case, a deep dive into Robert Jackson at a time when a lot of those papers are no longer available to us. And so appropriate that here we are at the Jackson Center today to talk about what Superfund and our next speaker, Congressman LaFalce, and how this all connects together. And I think it's safe to conclude that really from our research that Justice Jackson, Robert Jackson at the time, was really the first environmental lawyer. I mean, he really took to task and took to task the variety of experts that came in from the city, because the city's thrown a lot of these heavyweights, a lot of credentialed people, and obviously we still got a plaintiff's verdict.
Can I just wind up my remarks by saying that I talked to the other Martocci here, Judge Martocci, and he and I both, again, praised Greg Peterson for what he's done with the Jackson Center and with Jackson locally, improved the community here, and then also educated internationally all the folks about Justice Jackson's history. And I salute you every time I...
Did you get that on film, Ed? I want to see that. Okay. Well, again, thank you, Mary D., for your wonderful work.
Thank you.
And thank you, Judge Gerasi, for all your research. And let's give them one final round of applause. Yeah.